the warmest color ever. And it's the largest, deepest spring in the world.
Citizens of Florida have long been proud of the fact that the world's largest and deepest spring can be seen at Wakulla.
Wakulla Springs is located in rural Wakulla County in North Florida.
Now, Wakulla, the Indian word, that means strange land and mysterious water.
Going on a boat tour at Wakulla Springs is experiencing what many call the real Florida.
Now, all this water we're traveling on here, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, is all part of the Wakulla River. All this water here is in our flow of that one big spring. The spring flows the river by 9 miles downstream to the St. Mawes River and into the Appalachia Bay where it all finally ends up into the Gulf.
Wakulla Spring gushes forth more than 250 million gallons of water a day, creating the mouth of the Wakulla River. It flows for 9 miles until it reaches the Gulf of Mexico. Wakulla Spring is connected to the longest and deepest freshwater cave system in the world. Leading up to the spring vent is the Wakulla Cave. It's a branching network of caves and tunnels that are part of the Floridan Aquifer, under the Woodville Karst Plain region of North Florida. Scientific interest in the spring began in 1850, when ancient mastodon bones were seen on the bottom of the spring. Since that time, scientists have identified the remains of at least 9 other Ice Age mammals, including the short-nosed bear and the saber-toothed tiger. Evidence of the first appearance of humans living around the spring was discovered in 1995 by state archaeologist Calvin Jones at the Wakulla Springs Lodge site. He unearthed a stone blade and Clovis spear points used during the Paleo-Indian period, dating back 12 to 15,000 years ago. Surrounded by a dense forest and swamp, Wakulla Springs has been controlled by many different interests since the 1500s, including the Spanish, Indian tribes, and American property owners. Ed Ball was the first owner to make it a popular tourist destination in the 1930s. He also wanted to make sure it remained protected from development.
I knew Mr. Ball probably as well as anybody ever knew Mr. Ball. Mr. Ball would come down to the springs and he would want me to get up early in the morning at about maybe 5:30 or 6, and I would take him down the river so that he could take his pictures and all those kind of things. Oh, Mr. Ball, he just loved the springs. I mean, he brought a lot of people there, particularly politicians. You know, he was quite a man with politics. When we'd go down on those trips, he'd stop and just sit there and look at the water and talk about how the water flowed and how pretty it was and how clean it was and things like that. So I would say that the springs was very dear to Mr. Ball.
Wakulla Lodge was built in 1937. Its lobby features an intricately painted wooden beam ceiling, Tennessee marble, and a 60-foot-long soda fountain.
Up the hill on the left-hand side is the historic Wakulla Lodge, built by business tycoon Ed Ball, who is responsible for the natural character of the river that you've enjoyed this afternoon.
However, he was criticized by some for building the lodge, sandy beach, and concrete boat docks. He also was controversial because he built a fence across the river and blocked off a road leading into the area.
And of course, everyone knows about the controversy with the fence across the river. However, if you know much about history and law, Florida, this part of Florida was part of the Spanish land grants. And under the Spanish land title, if you own water on your property, you own the rights under the water. It's called riparian rights. So he clearly owned the riparian rights, and he exercised those rights. And I've noted now that the state has the river And the springs, I don't think that fence has budged much.
I was there when Wakulla Springs burned. I was there and helped fight the fire, and more than anything else, enjoyed breaking the windows because they wanted you to break the windows. And so me and my buddies, we just threw rocks at the windows. We didn't do much firefighting. But then again, we weren't very old. Well, I did everything you can do there. I drove the jungle cruise. I sold the tickets at the jungle, you know, for the jungle cruise and for the glass bottom boats. I worked at what they call the concession stand. And I also worked in the locker room, opening lockers for the people. I'm not too sure. I either started in 1939, but I know I worked there in 1940, 41, and 42. And I also worked there in 1946, the year that Mrs. Ashmore and I got married. Same. The country still was poor. Nobody had a whole lot of money. But a lot of people came to Wakulla Springs because it was very popular back in before World War II and after World War II.
Wakulla Springs has been used for many different reasons. During World War II, the spring and river served as a training site for Army soldiers on their way to the South Pacific and Normandy. Live ammunition was used as well as igniting the surface of the spring. In the early 1940s, Hollywood was drawn to Wakulla Springs for its crystal clear water and its surrounding jungle of dense vegetation and ancient trees. Newt Perry is credited with bringing movie productions to Wakulla Springs. He also created several promotional underwater films highlighting the clarity of Wakulla's water. Beginning in 1938, several of the original Tarzan films were shot on location at Wakulla Springs.
Swim.
Because they brought elephants and they brought monkeys and, not monkeys, but whatever it is they brought. Johnny Sheffield, the boy, now he was around, but he was kind of spoiled and a nuisance. As far as Mr. Wisemiller was concerned, you know, I knew him and he knew me and I took care of his swim fins and I'd run a little bit of errands for him, but I was not a part of the program.
Other films such as Creature from the Black Lagoon, Airport 77, and Joe Panther were also filmed there. Rico Browning was attending Florida State University and working as a lifeguard. He went on to be the gill man in The Creature from the Black Lagoon. Browning became a successful writer, director, actor, and producer in Hollywood. In addition to movies, the Florida State College for Women's synchronized swimming team, the Tarpon Club, practiced at the spring. Beauty contests and photo shoots were also common at the spring. Old Joe was known to all employees and many visitors of the spring.
Old Joe was there, yes. He would sun out there and he never bothered nobody. He seldom ever moved off of the log and all that he used to sun on. But nobody messed with Old Joe. I mean, he was there, but he was up, like you had the tower and all the clear water, and then back up that way was where he was on the lily pad.
Old Joe was shot and killed in 1966 by Wilton Amos Skibo Ross, who was convicted of murdering his wife.
I wouldn't say it was sad, but I knew it was useless for somebody to shoot him. You know, you just hate to see something destroyed for no reason at all.
They can swim up and down the rivers at their leisure. Another alligator coming up on the left-hand side. I see some foam on the surface as if he might have been active, maybe pursuing that second smaller alligator swimming away from him. That alligator saying, river isn't big enough for both of us. Out of here, it's my river.
In 1987, George Cummings, a Florida State University college student, was killed by an 11-foot bull alligator while snorkeling in an unauthorized area. That 415-pound predator was destroyed by park rangers. For 90 years, guides have been giving their tours.
Even before this was a state park, there's been tour guides on the river to take people out and entertain them and educate them. And what they do is not like, there's nothing else quite like it.
This looks like a long, slender bass, but let's get a little closer and get a closer view. Bird will have no problem with this fish, I predict.
Is he trying to use the branch?
Yes, he is. And that is a little.
That's a happy.
Look at his.
That's a happy bird there. Absolutely.
Oh, it is right. It's flexing gently.
Oh. No.
I have been working here at Wakulla Springs for a total of approximately about 34 years.
Many of the guides grew up in Wakulla County and have passed on their sing-song patter and chanting style to their relatives.
Yes, quite a few of my relatives done boat rides here. Actually, it's been more of a family tradition of Gavin's working here at Wakulla Springs during the years. Basically, my father worked here, my uncle worked here, and a whole lot of my relatives worked. And I sort of adapted my style of doing boat rides from them, which I would say was the old-fashioned way, sort of.
That's a big old saw shell turtle that's on the bottom now. Yeah.
And I want y'all to know one thing, folks. They are very much alive. This is no Disney World. Everything out here is for real. Y'all won't find nothing running around here, no Mickey Mouse. He gators off for real. Y'all missed that one on the bank. Look, there's another big one right there in the grass right here on the right by the boat back here. Line them under that wild prickly weed over there.
And each of the rangers have a different sort of style that they, in which they give their tour. If you tried to experience this park without the tour guides, it would not be quite the same.
Many visitors have remarked that mullet look like sharks. To me, mullet look like mullet.
He's out there. If I throw you in, he will come and get you.
I'm fishing around here now on the left right there. As you all go in your byways and highways, you may go by Amoco or Texaco or Exxon or Chevron. Out here I got a Shell station for y'all. Look at that old alligator pulling up into the Shell station over there. Yeah, that's our Shell station now, y'all.
Henry, the pole vaulting fish, was a favorite attraction for the glass bottom boat drivers to point out to visitors.
Henry, jump it again, little fella, jump it. Wake up now, and hear what I say. Jump it again, little fella, jump it. Hey, y'all, good luck, Henry. All right.
That's kind of hard to say, because I first started down here when I was a little bit there. Probably about 19 years old, I used to follow my grandfather down here, which drove boats down here for about 33 years. Before that, my first little job was pulling grass between those docks out there. After that, I went to the kitchen up there and started washing dishes and started to be a cook. Then I worked on the maintenance crew out there, and I was working in the lobby out there as a houseman, and I finally got down here on the boats. And I enjoyed it down here, so I made him a fine resting place right here. But my grandfather used to drive the boats all the time, so I kind of got my early experience from there. And my kind of style is that, I'm kind of like from the old school. Like I said, I learned from my grandfather and a lot of more older guys down here, Tone Gavin, H.D. Gavin, right around my grandfather's age, Hawk Jackson, a little bit younger, but I got from the old style.
The content to your left out there on top of that old dead grass. The largest bird down here on the river, the great blue heron, standing up tall and proud. Now, some people say it looks just like the bird on Sesame Street. That's the great blue heron out there. He's trying to find a little lunch out there right now.
So we got had a little chant and everything going out on the glass bottom boat, kind of a little chant and the way you pitch your voice and everything, so that kind of made it a little more interesting. And I'm old schooler.
The largest spring in the world, the Wakulla Springs. But now I hope you all had a thrill. We got a hotel and lodge up there on top of the hill. They got country fried chicken that ain't the please. Candy yams and black eyed peas.
Probably the most significant change in wildlife has been the manatees. In my duration, they first arrived in 97, came and left, and have been kind of sporadic up until this last year, and they came in the spring and are still here today.
Manatee.
And it's okay, everybody move over to the left-hand side. I haven't dumped over a boat yet today. No worries. Life preservers right over your head.
The above water part of the park on the boat tours is practically the same view as the first time I came here as a park visitor in the 1970s. The below water system has changed dramatically. Our river and spring has filamentous green algae in abundance, a reflection of the increase in nutrients in the water coming out of the spring.
Todd Kincaid is a hydrogeologist who has been studying Wakulla Springs and how area sinkholes and springs are interconnected.
My history with Wakulla is fairly long. I came here when I was 5 years old and took the boat tours and swam in the river and the spring and stuff like that. We know that the water from Wakulla Springs, the water coming out of Wakulla Springs comes from predominantly two sources. One source is what we call surface water, or it's rivers and streams that flow through this area but don't make it all the way to the Gulf of Mexico. They instead go into sinkholes and sink into the ground and go into the Floridan aquifer. And we know that surface water is one of the major components of the total amount of flow that comes to Wakulla Springs.
Florida springs have proven to be especially vulnerable to water runoff from development because the underground cave system is more interconnected than previously thought.
And we know that the other component of flow to Wakulla is groundwater that comes from a broader, larger geographic region and starts as rainfall and goes down into the ground and then flows underground to the spring. Where does the water come from? And for that, we've been using what we call groundwater tracers to trace the pathway of groundwater flow. And we started out by just trying to demonstrate to to the hydrogeological community, the scientific community, and the regulatory community that water flows through cave systems very rapidly. And so what we did with our tracers is injected tracers at one location in the conduit and then traced it as it moved through that conduit to another location and measured the velocity of the travel. And we surprised a lot of people by showing that this water moves at as much as a mile per day once it's in the conduits.
Hey there, mister. Where does this road go to?
For the last 20 years, the Woodville Karst Plain Project divers are the only ones permitted to explore its caves. In 2007, two divers completed the longest cave dive in history from one cave opening to another, finally proving that the vast underwater cave systems are linked.
The WKPP role evolved as well in the late 1990s and early 2000 in response to various threats here at Wakulla Springs, environmental threats, increasing nitrate pollution, increasing dark water days as a result of the runoff into the sinkholes from the Northwest. The main goal of the project when it was originally formed was to map and explore these cave systems, document them, and ultimately link all these cave systems together, because for more than 50 years it's been speculated that one way or another they were physically connected. On June 23rd, 2007, we entered here at Wakulla Springs and explored out from the entrance here almost 24,000 feet one way and returned 24,000 feet. So that in itself is a world penetration record. And then on December 15th, 2007, we returned here to the Woodville Karst Plain to plan and execute the traverse from Turner Sink to Wakulla Springs. The traverse distance was roughly 7 miles or almost 36,000 feet. So our role has now expanded to the role of researcher, educator, in addition to explorer, and it's something we're quite proud of.
This area is under a lot of stress, mostly because of uncontrolled growth.
Men, by draining marshes and polluting streams and rivers, have almost eradicated the freshwater snail, which forms the limpkin's principal food. And with no snails to eat, the limpkin dies. Its protective coloration enables it to hide in the light and shade of its background. But its main characteristic is its weird, wailing cry, which at night sounds like the scream of a soul in distress.
We have lost the limpkin on the Wakulla River. And we're not really sure why that happened, but when the apple snail population disappeared, so did the limpkins.
Scientists say one of the main threats to the Wakulla Springs ecosystem is increasing nitrate levels in the water. Nitrates are introduced into the environment as byproducts of municipal sewage treatment and disposal, residential septic systems, agriculture, fertilizer use, and livestock farms.
But a lot of the uplands that provides the water that comes, you know, the drainage from the uplands goes into the karst system and it comes down. So a lot of those uplands have become housing developments now. So where you had natural runoff before, now you have runoff from the streets, and you have where they're on septic tanks, you have that contributing factor to the aquifer. So there's a lot of changes and a lot of things that have been happening that threaten the natural systems.
There's a consensus that if northern Wakulla County and southern Leon County don't develop wisely with sane septic system practices, that any improvements made by the city of Tallahassee with the wastewater treatment plant will be counterbalanced by the septic systems contributing nitrates.
The invasive species hydrilla appeared in 1997. The fast-growing aquatic weed chokes out native plants and creatures, blocks sunlight, depletes oxygen levels in the water. Park biologists use an aquatic herbicide to try and control the hydrilla.
So what has happened is that the nitrates have increased their concentration, and nitrates act just like a fertilizer. So while the water is safe to drink and it's okay for humans, it's not good for our native plants. And we have the algae growth has just grown exponentially, and also the invasive hydrilla plant takes real well to that nitrate. And we have pretty much uncontrolled growth of those plants now in the river.
Ever since we've done the herbicide treatment, I'm definitely more hopeful. We actually have the hydrilla under management now. We're controlling it, and we're reducing it over time. We're replanting eelgrass into the spring, into the river, in the park portions. The tannic water is a little more of a mystery. Why is the spring dark? And I'm not sure that's such a bad thing. It's bad because we can't see this crystal clear blue spring and take our glass bottom boats out over it and ooh and ah over the depths and the fish and stuff. But definitely, you know, I'm more hopeful than I was 5 years ago, especially because of the hydrilla and the impacts we've had to the hydrilla.
The research that we're doing centers on trying to measure the quantity and quality of water coming from the individual sources that contribute to Wakulla Springs. And for that, we use hydraulic or hydrologic meters, and we work with the Woodville Karst Plain Project divers to get these meters deployed at specific places in the cave systems. So not just Wakulla, but also in Leon Sinks and in Indian Springs, and potentially, or hopefully in the next year or so, we'll have them deployed at Spring Creek.
Years ago, a sinkhole owner 20, 30, 50, 100 years ago, landowners would use the sinkholes as a place to put their garbage. And there was the hole, you could put the garbage in and then it was gone. And sinkholes, they didn't realize what the connection was to their water. Everybody in Wakulla County drinks from this aquifer, whether you're on your own private well or the Talquin water system or some other municipal water system. We all have a straw going into the same glass. And that awareness has made, I think, the biggest changes.
Right now, this tour is about to end. And I do hope y'all come down and visit us again.